It's a pleasure to welcome Evie here to the College of Southern Maryland. I told her I wasn't going to go through her awards or degrees or anything like that, and I thought it would be more interesting maybe for you and for me, I'm selfish, that I talk to you about the experience that I've had in my classes as we've been prepping for Evie's visit. What we discovered in class over and over again reading Evie's poems is a hunger for the genuine we didn't know we had. We shared her poems like bread and water. We shared our own stories. And we listened to each other and we learned from one another that our lives do matter. And I have in parentheses here, even though teaching to the test over the last 15 years says otherwise, you know, some of my students think their lives don't matter. In an exchange of storytelling and discussion of Evie's work brings that out. Evie's words brought us affirmation and connection because her poems are a place for truth, a place to explore who we are as Americans, our headlines, police shootings, how we define ourselves, why we're so preoccupied with seeing others as less than us, our love affair with violence, how we treat each other with indifference, and how to fall in love with the shade of a tree in Tennessee. There's strong women in history and love and family on every page of her book. And I do hope you pick up, if you didn't get a copy of it, there's some out here and you can get a copy and Evie would be happy to sign it. We're gonna have a book signing after the reading. The voices from the past give us reminders of how to praise, how to leave the world a better place. And like all good poets, Evie has an ear for music, the music of her words, for accent and vocabulary and speech patterns. And in a world obsessed with the superficial, the soundbite, social media, political discourse, language is losing out, devalued. Evie's poems breathe life back into language, and she does it with calm assurance and courage, not turning away from the heart, from the gut. What are we here to learn at this college? Some would say a marketable skill, how to fit in. But some would say our job here is to learn to feel alive, to affirm, not to lose hope, even in today's climate, to celebrate the everyday, and to leave the world a better place. So in class, if all we can say is we had a few hours to speak from the heart about things that matter to us, share our own stories, listen to each other, learn from each other, and if Evie's poems helped us begin the conversation, begin the journey to becoming, I think you could say it was time pretty well spent. It is, after all, part of what makes her Evie. She grew up in the shadow of southern trees. Ladies and gentlemen, Evie Shockley.
Wow. Thank you so much, Neil. Thank you all for being here. It is an amazing pleasure. Of course, I'm going to get my water. It is such an amazing pleasure to be here. I have already had an hour or so of conversation with some of you. The students here just energized me so much with the passion and intensity of their questions and their answers. I came away with answers. And so I have... I begin with gratitude, and I hope I will leave you all with a good feeling of some sort. But not because these are going to be necessarily the most cheerful poems. some will. I'm going to start with poems from The New Black, which Neil was talking about earlier. And I'm going to begin with the poem that opens the book. It is a nostalgic poem for me to read now because it was written around the time that our current president took office. And feels like such a different moment just 8 years later. This is called My Last Modernist Poem, number 4. Or Re-Rebirth of a Nation. A clean-cut man brings a brown blackness to a dream-carved, unprecedented place. Some see in this the end of race, like the end of a race that begins with a gun, a finished line we might finally limp across. For others, this miracle marks an end like year's end, the kind that whips around again and again, an end that is chilling with a lethal spring coiled in the snow. Ask Lazarus about miracles. The hard part comes afterwards. He stepped into the reconstruction of his life, knowing what would come, but not how. So, I don't know if everyone grew up listening to stories about Lazarus on Sundays, but he was one of the people that, a person that was raised from the dead. And I imagine that things were trickier afterwards. So I'm going to read a poem that that was inspired in part by another friend of mine's art. We were talking about influences and the way art can generate art earlier. I have friends who do multimedia conceptual art, and their names are Mindy and Keith Obadike. And Keith, at one point, several years ago now, decided that he would sell his blackness on eBay. And it was up on auction for about 3 days before eBay took it down. But, you know, I really liked the idea of his blackness as something that he could, you know, sell. And it gave me permission to write a poem addressed to my blackness. So this is called Ode to My Blackness. You are my shelter from the storm. And the storm, my anchor and the troubled sea. Night casts you warm and glittering upon my shoulders. Some would say you give off no heat. Some folks can't see beyond the closest star. You are the tunnel John Henry died to carve. I see the light at the end of you, the beginning. I dig down deep and there you are at the root of my blues. You're all thick and dark, enveloping the root of my blues. Seem like it's so hard to let you go when I've got nothing to lose. Without you, I would be just a self of my former shadow. So this next poem was, these poems were all written in, many of these poems were written in around 2007, 2008. So you'll hear a lot of references to things that were in the news at that time. Hopefully some of the names or events will still be familiar, although the national amnesia, right? Things like, whew, it crawled across the screen and it just kept going. So, you know, you can ask me later. We can Google things. That's the way it works. The title of this poem, and we talked about this earlier for those who were at the conversation. The title of this poem is Improper T Behavior, and the TY are in parentheses. Improper T Behavior. Racial profiling, the idea that there's no legitimate reason for driving while black. Take Sean Bell. He got 50 bullets pumped into his car for driving while black. Home ownership is also improper behavior in Cambridge and beyond. Ask Henry Louis Gates, arrested in his own home for thriving while black. Seemed like the Obama celebratory fist bump might derail his campaign. Now they know they should avoid things like high-fiving while black. Inner city hoops are, of course, appropriate. Unlike swimming in the suburbs, the Creative Steps day camp kids were booted from a pool for diving while black. Even b-ball can fall out of bounds if the finals pitch you against a whiter team. The Rutgers women's players were slammed on the air for striving while black. Post-Katrina New Orleans is open to anyone with the money to rebuild, except the Ninth Ward, which they're discouraged from reviving while black. It's all about belonging. Even now, who belongs where is often based on who belonged to whom. I sometimes wonder how I get away with living while black. So, I actually, I wrote an additional stanza for the poem that was about Trayvon Martin, which occurred after this book was published. And sometimes I read it with that stanza, but I realize I didn't bring that copy with me. So just imagine it. You know the form now, right? This book is it's about several things, but one of the things that it was about was a feeling that I was having in the last decade. It seems crazy that this was, that we're in a new decade now, right? I was thinking about things that my students would say in class about race, and I was just like, how can you see this that way? But then I realized I would remember that I had conversations with my mother in which she would say things, and I would say, how can you see things that way? And she would say, the same thing back to me. And it got me thinking about how much the way we see race has so much to do with when we enter the stream of history, right? What you've lived through gives you a different experience than what you've read about. And it also gives you a different experience than what you see coming after you've lived through something else. It's, I was just in between some different experiences, and I started thinking about what world my nieces, who were born around this time, what world they were going to grow up in. And I was thinking about those things and listening to my mother sing to my nieces when they were newborns songs that she had sung to my sister and me when we were kids. And all of that started working into this next poem. It's called Duck, Duck, Redux. And there are two epigraphs. The first one is, those who cannot remember the past are doomed to repeat it. And that's George Santayana. And the second one is, those who cannot forget the past are destined to remix it. And that's me. All right. Duck, Duck, Redux. This is the way we wash our face, wash our face, wash our face. This is the way we wash our face so early in the morning. This is the way we segregate our schools in 1896. This is the way we segregate our schools in 2007. Mary had a little lamb, a bad, bad black sheep with three bags full of wool. It followed her to school one day, work one day, Wimbledon one day. It followed her to church one day, which was against the rule. This is the way we patrol the roads in the antebellum South. This is the way we patrol the streets in our shiny New York. Cue wedding bell. Oh, bring back my Shawnee to me. This is the way we appropriate black culture in the post-Reconstruction period. This is the way we appropriate black culture in the 21st century. This little piggy went to market, got mad bling for spitting whack rhymes and calling women hoes, and still wound up crying, wee, 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 all the way home. This is the way we use a noose in Jim Crow America. This is the way we use a noose in Gina, Louisiana. Little blues boy, come blow your horn. I'm sorry to tell you, but his horn's done gone. And as for the boy who used to blow so sweet, he's under a mountain of debt, working for minimum wage. This is the way we wash our hands of you historically. Throw you in the Atlantic, spray you with Birmingham hoses. This is the way we wash our hands of you today, with jerry-rigged levees. So early, so early in the millennium. So that is Duck Duck Redux. Yeah. It's a good time for a drink of water. The hard thing about a poem like that, and maybe in some ways about the next poem too, is it makes me think of one of my mentors and someone who I know is beloved to people in this room, Lucille Clifton. Do you all remember? She was the poet laureate, one of the poets laureate of the state some years back. She has these poems that are making you laugh, and in the same breath you're thinking, why am I laughing? And so she used to pretend like she didn't do that on purpose. But now I know, because I write these kinds of poems, that it's on purpose. So that means you get to laugh, but you also have to think, why am I laughing? Both. This next poem, I'm going to read the last suite of the book. These are short poems, they're called collectively the Farewell Letters, and there's a hyphen. We think of farewell as a goodbye, but I like to remind myself that there's a wish in it. And they go very fast, they move on sonic association, and just let it wash over you. Grab whatever comes your way. The Farewell Letters. Dear Ace Bandage, the wound is hard to place. The wound is not your job. I thought I needed you, but things are already tight. You are like putty in my hands, or is my thinking colored? Flesh tone or dial tone? Who you gonna call? Your pretty silver brooch sets in, holds you at attention. Could it clasp the skin together long enough for the two flaps to reattach? Mismatch, rematch, love, ace, deuce, game, open. Dear cuddly Dharma, you make it easy to say no, just. I turn a blind eye to temptation after staring hard into your hydrogen smile. We spoon, and I hate to stir, but fetish is always in the mix. Even fate looks glamorous by lamplight, spotlight, hot. Wound or wood or wooden, batter, you have a dream of nightmarish proportions. Where there's a will, there's a way, unanchored, unmoored, off. Dear existential fallacy, I need you to be concrete. You need me to liquidate my account. Poor me with my fluid tale to hear you tell it. Fluent in six currencies, dirty lucre. You tracking bills counterfeited by the page. Liar, pants the town crier, griot, seer, seek, psych. That baby went out with the dirty dishwater. Cross my palm with olives, I'll tell you your pastime. Your passive voice is dated. Dear gift horse, open wide, now bite down. That incident was not an accident. Don't act like I'm stupid. Do you come with a saddle? Which way to the sunset? That's the thing about possibility. It's dark in there. You can't judge an R&B song by its covers, colors. Dolores is blue. Why must she give up her security blanket? She's had it since she was born. My, what sharp teeth you have. All the better. Dear Inkjet, black fast, greasy lightning, won't smear, won't rub off. Defense, a visual screen, ask an octopus. Bio-aqua-do-loop, footprints faster than a speeding bully, tracking dirt all over the page. Make every word count. One, two, I am, octoroon, half-breed, mutt, mulatto. Why are there so few hybrids on the road? Because they can't reproduce. Trokey choking, okay, mocha. Ebony, by contrast, says so much. Dear kerosene lamp, I thought I'd put you behind me. You're still there, back in the day, but casting your glow into my future. Casting call, cattle call, who you gonna call? What gets you fired up? A decent fuel, feud, food for thought. Wiki, 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 I carry a torch for you. Daytime decor, nighttime necessity, curiosity. Dare we step beyond your radiant radius? Holy, holy, antiquated, the way we live now. Dear mid-afternoon nap, allow me, no, after you, to take a break and make it last forever. What's up with the pointy ears? What planet are you from? Questions as old as the stars, scars, slurs. We go boldly into new worlds, all our expectations intact, no new ideas, secret hopes of meeting our own warped selves in poor disguise. Gauzy, hazy, who's he? You? Me? Wake up, whenever you are. Morning bells, here? Ring, rang, wrong. Dear opaque policy, transparency is the new this is for your own good. Covering your ears is a sound defense. The status quo never looked so good. Goods and servers. Ye gods, the national security blanket is a crazy quilt. A ward, a wash, away, AWOL, a globe warming up to consumption. He's got the whole world in his lands, friends, ends. Trust me, must we? Survey says property and life and liberty, but only if you're not it. Tag. Dear Quaalude residue, you left a coating of many colors along the walls of my veins. Bloodstream, mainstream, settle down. It's no game, this trivial pursuit of happiness. Are we there yet? When reality doesn't go down easy, take something that will. What are we waiting for? I'm shaken, but not stirred. Who cares? Shares, tears, cloud our eyes, billows, borrows, wheelbarrows, red and full of white chickens. Now you can rest. Dear safety test, do not pass go. Do not pass on. Do not collect goose eggs. Don't risk it all. Resistance is fertile, fragile, versatile. Can you steal home? Can you steal away? We need results. You need dummies. Let's make a wheel again from the beginning. The skin is the first layer of defense. If this were a real emergency, you would receive an SOS calling all black folks. Come in, come out. Ready or not, I ain't got long. Dear untimely violet, I doubt you or your rich hue. Your sturdy whisper has no credibility in the era of precautionary bombing. Greed wants war, need fights it. Bread for ammo, sent for you yesterday. Here comes trouble, come in trouble. Hits like a glove, boxes, fits like a love, clings, rhymes with trigger, and don't neither one mean no good. I'd rather the bullet, go on, pull it, afraid? Chicken sticks, names will never let go. Dear white Xmas, cross my heart, heat, hurt, an insulting injury. The wound is hard to place. Oh, ooh, X marks the spot, spooky. Tis the season to be haunted, attached to the past, in the grip of ships. Ahoy, unmoored, a pale ailment, hail and well meant, meant well, enough. Frothy, snow-capped waves, an icy greeting, a cold snap, slap, slip, a light mare, lightly whipped, screamy, hissy, fit to be tied. A tempered tantrum, just like the ones I used to throw. Dear yesterday's zero, you were a beacon of just is, an iron maiden carrying a dark torch. You're off for tomorrow's equation with a long fixed formula. The sum is greater. Here's a new math, maybe involving less division, a chance to set a light out for the territories. Suited you to a T to sink a hole in one, E pluribus, the same old unum. Today the game has changed. New rules, you've met your match. Score for now, love all. So that is a little tour through the New Black. And let's see how we're doing on time. I'd like to read a few poems from my now forthcoming book. Very excited. Next year this time, it will be out. It is called Semi-Automatic. And it's a book in which I've been thinking a lot about, not less about history, but if the New Black was about the way the present and the past connect with an eye to the past, I think Semi-Automatic is doing the same thing, but with an eye to the present moment. So I'll just begin with the opening poem of this new book. It's called, are there any Prince fans in the audience? Yeah, okay, so you'll hear a couple of references to him. Just, this is another poem that works in much the same fashion as the farewell letters. Quick sonic chains of thought. It's called, that's a rap sheet music for Alphabet Street. If I sang the blues, would that be new or new? Would booze follow blues? Would blood follow bud, flower, flow, sang froid, cold-blooded, hot-blooded, male? If I sang frigid, would that be cool? Jazzy, jizz, buzz, the word. Do I have the right to write the body? The right body to remain silent? Habeas corpus, to have the remains dans mes mains, my main man, handyman, unhand me, uncuff me, so I can speak in my signifying language. Signs, wonders, miracles, temptations, three or four tops. Hip-hops, micro-brouhahas, address them and drop the mic. Ain't nothing new, son, about us being under the gun. Checked in the black box, never a dull minute. Oh, pen it, mighty muse, flighty music, put the light letters together. Take it away. All right. We have, we've been dealing with some hard stuff for a little while, and I did think it would be appropriate to read a couple of poems that are just fun. It's harder just to move about on this. I've got my new manuscript, electronic form. This next poem is called Lotto Motto. First thing, I'm gonna paint the toothbrush red. I'm gonna quit my jalopy. I'm gonna whip up a few dead horses and put them out to passion. I'm gonna wash up on some distant score. First thing, I'm gonna get the expel out of Dodge. I'm gonna run like the wound. I'm gonna wash away our skins. I'm gonna blow this icicle point, first thing. First thing I'm gonna do, I'm gonna freeze dry my clown wig. I'm gonna stumble under your breath. Yeah, I'm gonna make like Elvis and exit the gilding. I'm gonna spit out that taste of punch, then wash my mouth out with hope. Are you kidding me? First thing, I'm gonna hit the toad. I'm gonna get down to brass tracks. I'm gonna head for the thrills if it's the last thing I do. And then I feel bad reading this poem after Neil gave an introduction in which he emphasized truth. And I feel like I have a lot of engagement with truth and you know, urgent issues. But this is a poem that I always disclaim is based in an untruth, and I'll tell you afterwards. It's called acrobatic, and for those who are, you know, playing the poetry form game, it's an abecedarian. Acrobatic. Acrophiliac, I'm not, so don't try putting me on the balance beam. The rings, too, are a bad idea. It doesn't help having chalk on my hands. It seems that when you think of me, you think daredevil, but that's just ignorant. Everybody knows I'm a close-to-the-mat freestyler, just bouncing along to the music from Rocky. You couldn't get me as far off the ground as the uneven bars. Heights make my skin break out and my eyes implode. Since as far back as I can remember, I've avoided jungle gyms. If God meant us to climb, he'd have given all kindergartners tails. You'll never catch me on a ski lift, a ski slope, or a ski. There are just too many ways to die when you start fucking with altitude. Next, you'll be asking me to high dive. Listen, I need my oxygen. If I was any taller, I'd get dizzy parting my hair. Surely you know that mountains are, without question, the greatest mistake Mother Nature made. Give me one good reason to ride a roller coaster. I don't even like mood swings. You can keep the carnival. The flying trapeze is an absolute no-go, even with a safety net underneath. I start dragging my heels at the suggestion of the pole vault. I'd never let go. I'll watch the fabulous Janelle Monáe walk the tightrope all day, but that's not my dance. I'm as zenial as anyone, but my out-of-towners don't get tours of towers. My yoga routine revolves around downward-facing dog. Really, not even Zeus in his swan suit could sweep me off my feet. Of course, I am not afraid of heights. But I started writing it, and then it just went. It just went. So I want to read a poem from a suite that, let's see, how are we doing on time? How much time do I have? About 5 minutes? Okay. I want to read a poem from a suite that was inspired by a need I felt to reclaim a character from, not from history, but from literary history. Have any of you ever read Uncle Tom's Cabin? Some? Okay, and everyone's heard of it, right? This is the novel that was said to have started the Civil War. That novel is worth reading in your lifetime for that historical value, if nothing else. It's an interesting book for all that its heart is in the right place. The African-American characters that Harriet Beecher Stowe, the author, created nonetheless leave a lot to be desired, certainly from a contemporary audience point of view. I started thinking about Topsy, who's a little girl, black girl enslaved, who appears in the book, and she. It would take too long for me to tell you all about her. I hope you'll encounter her at some level in her original form, but maybe it's best if some of you are encountering her first, as I have reimagined her. This is a poem in which I imagine her as a kind of spirit that can possess some people, for better or for worse. And this is called Topsy Talks About Her Role. I don't mean to get into their heads. I just go. It's like I'm possessed too, as if my mind and body aren't my own. Anyhow, it's all in the timing. If I desert a girl too soon, she'll end up 30 before she's 13, dragging around a burden as big as a church at an age when some young women ain't weighing nothing heavier than which purple they want for their pedicure. But if I hold a sister too long, not a thing on earth can tether her. Now, this Sandra was anything but bland. I was hooked. I do like to ride a tongue that's limber, that can keep up with the flash of my spirit. She had a dancing mouth, the kind that could give you warm, such warmth, or just as easily give you hot if called for. I know where I'm welcome. I was still cutting capers behind her smile the week she died. I overstayed. In Texas, parts of Chicago too, pickaninny droll don't come in women's sizes. You can set whatever tone you want with a pair of baby blues. But when I roll black women's brown eyes, they always turn into sapphires. And I think one last poem. I asked earlier if anyone knew Nina Simone. Are there any Nina Simone fans in the audience? Okay, great. Does anyone know the visual artist Romare Bearden? A couple of people? All right, this is good. You have to go look up his work. He created a suite of, his visual art was done in collage, like Matisse in that form. And he did a suite of collages that he called Black Odysseys. And it was a retelling of Odysseus's epic. And I started thinking about his art. He and Nina Simone, who are both from North Carolina, and the stories of Bearden and Simone and Odysseus and Circe, one of the witches, witch figure who appears in the Odyssey, and all of their voices started to come together for me. And so the poem is made up of little fragments of lines, some of which may be Circe's voice, some Odysseus, some Nina, some Bearden, Romare Bearden, and sometimes combinations or even all of them at the same time. This is what I call a song lyric acrostic, which means that instead of spelling just a name or something like that down the side, the first word of each line down the left margin gives us a Nina Simone lyric. And you're going to hear, for those who are keeping track, her song, I Put a Spell on You, right? 'Cause you're mine. Okay, you're going to hear some of her song titles, some of Bearden's painting titles, a story of sorts. Circe, Odysseus, Black Odysseys, a remix collage for Romare Bearden and Nina Simone. I am black but sorceress. I mean trouble. Gonna put long uneasy miles between me and my home, but it's not a one-way ticket. This here is Circe's domain. Come on in and set a spell. Hey, wanderer, the north's no escape, just another stop on some lonesome railroad line. Listen, rejection's telling you to improvise. Little girl blue, cotton blue, I do you this way 'cause I can. You bring your beast to my door, you're asking for trouble. Look, when I tell it, the Odyssey is mine. If the gods spew at you their red-eyed fury, you might not ever find home. Harlem swings me a little better. Philadelphia loves me some, brother. Carolina won't stop me from shadowing my passion. Pierce me with your other spear, the one that won't leave me bleeding. You and me, we can pursue things under these wide blue skies that will surely make you forget about home. I got the sea chasing me. What can I do but keep moving? Barbados, Aia, St. Martin. I follow the blue-black keys where they lead. Bebop. Oh, you ain't seen the full power of my mojo, baby. Who's lying to who? Believe me, my wand doubles as a sword. I swear, my voice is honey and venom. Picture Ithaca. I assemble love from cut-up color, canvas, and glue. Daddy, if a year is all you got to give, give it here. Forever's a big blue illusion anyhow. See all the skulls? Marriage won't outlast freedom, and Liberia ain't the same as liberty. Tell me, how can I trust a woman with a snake for a bracelet? Well, it don't mean a thing if it ain't got that sting. Why should I care about Penelope if you don't? If yellow, if red, if orange, if green, if blue, it's true. I'm dying to hear the siren song. You shape your future from your past. The geometry of don't can be transformed. Troubled women walking. I want to bring forth the people. An outrageous magic shakes me. Everybody knows about Mississippi. Many men destroyed. I'm blue, but I won't be blue always. Never forget my pillow is yours. Red sun shining against a full moon. Night noon's a sign, right? X marks the spot. One last stab at some kind of home. Now go, get back out there and do what you were born to do. Thank you. I think it goes back to what we were talking about earlier today. I'm jealous of musicians and of visual artists, and so I try to recreate some of what they do in my poetry. You can hear that in the poems that I talked about as being just sonic. I try to bring the music into the language, and if you ever have a chance to look at the way they are on the page, you can see that I treat the page sometimes as a canvas. And so, you know, when I realize that words somehow still are not actually notes or colors, I make reference to the work that I am jealous of. Yeah. Thank you. The New Black. So what I was thinking about when I gave it that title, I had several thoughts. I was thinking, obviously, about the fashion reference, right? The fashion industry is in it for your money. I'm not immune. I try, you know, not to go shopping too much. But the thing about the fashion industry is that if the little black dress was good all the time, then you wouldn't be buying more clothes. So every year or two, they have to tell you that, you know, pink is the new black or red is the new black. I'm not going to say the other one. You know what I'm thinking about, right? So this was before that. This is not about that. I started thinking about how that idea of a cyclical something replacing black, but always referencing back to that original, you know, color, right? How that played out in thinking about race in my experience, right? And so, what would it mean? What could be the new black? And how is it connected to whatever the old black was, right? And for those of you who study African American literature, you know, this is my scholarship as well. I'm thinking also of echoes of the New Negro, which was the movement that underlay the Harlem Renaissance. And I'm also thinking about the Black Arts Movement when the poetry of that era was called the New Black Poetry, right? So there's always this idea of something new coming along, displacing what had come before. But we never really get past the past And that's the tension that I was interested in. You know, like, I think I've got it, and then I find titling really hard. So often it's the last thing that I come to, and by that time I'm just so grateful to have discovered one. It is most often that the title comes last, but every now and then, I'm trying to think if I have a specific example. It's hard for me to think of one now that where the title comes first. For me, titles are really important. They are very much part of the poem, but I like to use them to kind of, how to put this, often my poems are kind of elliptical. They make a lot of references and they're not necessarily easy to follow chronological narratives or things like that. And for me, it's at the end of writing a poem when I see, okay, what does someone need to be thinking about before they start reading to kind of have a better chance of getting in the space where I want them to be. And that's how I come up with the titles. So they really usually come last. Yes, I mean, you are pointing to every writer's, point of frustration, and that is that the publishing process takes forever. So what that means fundamentally in this case is that I turned in my manuscript to the publisher at the beginning of September, and it will be August before it has gone through copy editing and design and, you know, the whole, you know, there's proofs, there's so many stages, and it takes about a year. A year is fast for print publishing, and I feel very lucky to be able to say August 2017 as opposed to something even farther off. Thanks for that, yeah. The best worst question ever. All right, so I already mentioned Lucille Clifton, right? I think the first favorite poet I ever had was Gwendolyn Brooks. I studied undergrad in Chicago, and so I was reading her in the city where she was from and where she was poet laureate also of her state. My love goes really far and wide. So I have mentioned Harriet Mullen a lot today. She's the person who inspires a lot of the puns in my poetry. I would mention poets like Brenda Hillman and Ed Roberson, who are both poets who've helped me think about how to talk about nature in my poetry. I didn't read necessarily poems that were foregrounding that today, but it's a big through line in what I'm thinking about, like the nature in terms of outdoors in the South and also environment and some of those issues. I was talking with Rachel on the way over from dinner about Sharon Olds, who I've loved for a long time. I mean, I could give you a list of reading. I mean, right now, some of the people I'm teaching in my course are among my favorite poets: Sonia Sanchez, Ross Gay. Oh my God, it goes on and on. And I think that reading widely is part of what makes my poetry go in a lot of different directions. I like to take it all in. So, thanks for that. Sometimes I have a couple of things in progress at the same time. We were talking earlier about how where you are at the moment you're writing is not a place that you ever really come back to. So I try to draft something. It won't be finished, but it'll be drafted all in one sitting. Sometimes that doesn't even work because of just the way life interrupts and that kind of thing. But most often, once I start working on one piece, I'm going to be coming back to that. And if something else starts to percolate, I might write down a line or two so I don't forget. But I'll try to finish the one I've started while I still see things the same way, if that makes sense. Yeah, but there's no right or wrong way to do it. Yeah. Thank you all. You've been great. I appreciate your time.